Can you tell him tonight? Say, Jesus, here I am.
Good morning. You glad to be in the Lord's house today? I want to welcome everyone. Glad to have you. It's a great looking crowd today. Did you come to praise the Lord? Stand to your feet. Do you believe that through Him nothing is impossible? Do you believe it? Do you believe through Him nothing is impossible? One, two, three, four. that you gives me strength. Nothing is impossible through you. Blind eyes are open. Strongholds are broken. I am living by faith. Nothing is impossible. to turn your attention to the screens for today's announcements.
And since Fourth Fest is coming up, I hope that he will let me sing this year. I'm proud to be an American, where at least I know I'm free. And I won't forget the man who died, who gave that right to me, and I gladly stand up next to you. I don't really know the rest of the words. Cut.
Hold up.
A busy summer here at SFA, so let's go ahead and get started with some of the news. VBS is right around the corner. It's going to be July 10th through the 13th. The theme this year is a mega sports theme. It is going to be amazing, so much fun, but we need your help. Lots of volunteers, so make sure that you sign up at the Welcome Center. The book club is going to be Thursday, June 30th at 6:30 here in the Fellowship Hall. They will be going over chapters 5 through what we love missions here at SFA, and next Sunday is Mission Sunday. Also, we have another women's prayer meeting coming up. It's going to be July 11th at 11 a.m. That should be easy to remember. 11:11. Last but not least is the Fourth Fest, and of course, that's on July 4th. Fireworks will be at 9:30 at Lake John Wells in Stigler. We want everyone to show up, but we also are going to be needing volunteers. We need people that will help park cars, and so we need you to sign up at the Welcome Center if you are willing to help. And make sure to get ready next week to bring all your family and friends out and watch some awesome fireworks. Okay, that's all that I have, and I'm going to leave Pastor Jason with the joke of the day. So how about those hogs? Go Razorbacks! Woo Pig Suey!
How about them Sooners? That kind of went over well, didn't it? Anyway, it is so good to be in the house of the Lord this morning. I know, man, it's summertime, people travel, things going on, but we are here today, and we're here to worship the Lord. And so I want to just continue to encourage you to be faithful to the Lord's house. A lot of great stuff going on, as you saw just now in the news. One of the things that I do want to mention is our students, our young people, got back from camp this past Friday, and they had a tremendous time. I had the privilege to go up on Thursday evening, was a part of their evening worship service, and it was just a tremendous time to be in the presence of the Lord, worshiping with several hundred young people. And I want to take this opportunity to say thank you to those that sponsored our youth and also our children. Our kids will be going here in a few weeks as well. But your investment made a difference, and so we want to thank you. Tonight at 6 o'clock, I'm going to be preaching a message out of the book of 2 Kings chapter 2. And we're also going to be celebrating our young people. They're going to give some testimonies, and I'm going to be preaching the message. So I want to encourage you to be here tonight at 6 o'clock as we see the fruit of your investment and we celebrate what God did in and through their lives. Amen. I'm going to ask our ushers, if they would, to come to receive this morning's tithe and offering. And as they come, during the offering this morning, you are going to see a very short video from our Waymaker outreach yesterday. We are having a tremendous impact through this clothing and food pantry. We were privileged with the opportunity, and Miss Michelle will mention this in the video, but we were privileged to minister to 37 families yesterday. Come on, church, let's give the Lord a good hand clap. Of those 37 families, only three of them were here the previous month. So that means 37 families, only three of them were here the previous month. So that means there were 34 new families that we were able to provide a necessity and a need And I want to just echo thank you for the team of folks that came yesterday and served all day long. There's some folks that were here, and you know who you are. We're so thankful for you, and we know that God's going to bless you. So this morning, we honor what God is doing. I want to say thank you for your faithfulness and your tithe and your offering. It is truly making a difference, and it is going towards making an impact for the kingdom. So thank you for your faithfulness. I'm going to pray, and then we want to show you that short video, and then we're going to worship the Lord a little bit more. Heavenly Father, we come before you this morning, and Lord, we're just reminded, Lord God, of your grace and mercy for our lives. Lord, we want to say, Lord, thank you for your goodness. Lord, as we worship in song now, we worship in our giving to you. Lord, we do this because, God, we know that everything that we have is a direct result of your blessing. And, Father, we give, Lord, to not only to be obedient, but, God, just to see your kingdom furthered and impacted, Lord, for your glory. So, Father, this morning we give, Lord, of our tithe and our offering, Lord God. We pray that you would bless, Lord, both the gift and the giver. Bless this church, Lord God. And Father, we know that you're going to continue to be faithful. And Lord, we love you and we thank you in Christ's name. Amen. Check out this video real quick as we give this morning.
Good morning, SFA. This is Michelle with Waymaker Food and Clothing. We had this room completely full, top to bottom of shelves, table completely full, refrigerator, freezer full. It is completely empty. We had to go refill on food at 11:30. We have big families that we fed, praise God, and I prayed for God to multiply this time for our third month. We tripled last month. We fed 36 families. Some of them were big families of 9 and 6 and 5, but God is good. And so we're gonna partner up and we're gonna get to feed more people. So the more donations you can help with food, or when we get with the food bank to buy more groceries. And we're just so thankful for today. And I want to thank you, all the volunteers, for volunteering and people donating a second time to help out this need that we have in our community today. Love God, love people. See you.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Sister Michelle. And thank you to the folks that helped make that happen. Food pantry and clothing ministries and things of that nature are so important because as you study the life of Jesus, oftentimes before he preached one sermon, he would meet a need. You know, whether it was multiplying a few fish or a few loaves of bread, whether it was healing someone, there was always a need that was met. And I believe there was a reason behind that. And that is that people don't care how much you know until they know how much you care. And the Waymaker Food Pantry is one of the many things that we're doing here, God, but we also care. And thank you for caring. And as you can see, Sister Michelle showed you an empty food pantry, and it wasn't because it was lacking when they began, but we met a lot of needs. Many of you sacrificed and gave. We're really close to being able now to partnering with the food bank out of McAllister, which is going to be a tremendous help. But continue to bring those foods and various things. If you have any questions, please see Sister Michelle. I'm going to ask us to stand, and we're going to worship. We're going to worship the Lord just for a few moments. But as we enter into a time of praise and as we enter into a time of worship, I want us to pause just for a moment. And if there's any needs in this house, I want us to take time just to surrender those things to the Lord, because the same God that parted the Red Sea, the same God that delivered his people, the same God that empowered those to overcome the enemy is the same God that's here today. And we're going to sing about that in just a moment. But I mention that because some of you are here and you have needs. And this is your opportunity to say, you know what, I want to surrender those things to the Lord. And so just by an uplifted hand, if you have a need this morning, just lift that hand. I'm going to trust and believe that God's going to meet those needs. Also, as we pray and as we worship, these altars are open. And if you want prayer, feel free. We'll meet you down here and pray with you as well. But let's trust God. We serve the same God yesterday, today, and forever. So let's surrender these needs. Heavenly Father, we come to you today. And Father, you saw every hand that was raised. You know every need, that Father, that it represents. And Lord, I know that God, that many of us, the enemy has tried to convince us that, Lord, there's not in that prayer, that there's not an answer to that need. But God, we know that you are the same God yesterday, today, and forever. We know that you are a God that is able to meet us right here this morning and meet these needs. Lord, it doesn't matter if it's physical, spiritual, emotional, financial. Lord, it doesn't matter. But God, we know that you're faithful. And as we have lifted our hands, God, we've done so acknowledging this morning that we need you in this house. So, Father, we surrender our needs to you today. And, Father, we pray that heaven would open and that, Lord, that you would meet our needs in a way that only you can. Father, we praise you, Lord. We know that you are a faithful God. And, Lord, now we surrender to you. And as we do so, God, we also begin to worship you this morning. Lord, we lay aside what's going on the rest of the day, Lord, and we focus right now on what you want to do in and through our lives, Lord. Father, we know that the heart of worship, Lord God, Lord, comes from within. Lord, it's not about, Lord God, what is going on around us and what we're going through. Lord, worship is about what you have done, who you are, and the glory that you deserve in the hearts of your people. So, Father, Lord, our attention is on you today as we lift up the name that is the most powerful name, and that is the name of Jesus. Lord, we declare it to you this morning in Christ's name. Come on, church, let's worship the Lord this morning.
We want you to enter in today. When we had practice this morning, the whole praise team gathered around and prayed. You know, and we just felt like that for the last several weeks we'd been up here. And there was more of a performance and observation. We're here to praise. We're here to lead you in praise. We want you to enter in. You know, Brother Jason requested we do this song today, and as I was building the set list, and it seemed like every song almost came back to, I know that you keep your covenant. I'm calling on the God of Moses, the one who opened up the ocean. I need you now to do the same thing for me. Yes, for me. Oh God, my God, I need you. Oh God.
You are the same.
changing, never changing. I'm calling on the Holy Spirit. Almighty River, come and fill me up. Amen. Same God that you serve today.
Fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. Come unto me, all ye who weary and are heavy laden, and I'll give you rest. I'm your peacemaker this morning. Whatever you need, I am. Just as I said to Moses at the burning bush. For some of you this morning are having a burning bush experience. And I am here to tell you, says the Spirit of God, I am. I am your I am.
Hallelujah to your name, Jesus. Come on, church, let's just receive that word this morning. Lord, you do not give us the spirit of fear, Lord, of power, of sound mind, not of mind. Father, we worship you. Lord, we just worship you right now. Come on, church, let's just... Let's just exalt him just for a moment. Lord, we lift you up. We're thankful that you are here today. We're thankful, God, that we're not just going through the motions, but you're here with us and you're moving in our lives right now. Father, this word that has went forth, Lord, we receive tonight. Lord, we trust in you. We know that you are the same God yesterday, today. Father, we declare that over our hearts. We declare it over our lives. We declare, Lord, it over our minds. For those of us that are battling fear, we pray for the peace of your Holy Spirit to rule and to reign within our hearts and within our lives. We worship you. Church, don't get so far ahead in the service that you miss on what God wants to do in your life right now in this moment. Last Sunday night, we preached a message. And the message was entitled, Comfortable with the Devil and Scared of Jesus. And in the message, we said that Jesus came on the scene to a man that had been bound by demons, legions of demons. The religious had tried to shackle him. The people around him had tried to shackle him with chains, but repeatedly the demon would break the chains to a point that they had just become comfortable with it. Were so scared of Jesus that they sent him away. And we were challenged with the question is, what did this city miss out on? Because they were scared of what Jesus was doing, that they sent him away. And we preached how we never want to send the Lord away because he's doing something different than our schedule omits or permits. So Lord, right now, before we go any further, Lord, I pray right now, Holy Spirit, that you would touch the heart and lives of your people. And as we look to your word here in just a moment, I pray that our hearts would be prepared and ready to receive. Lord, let us not send your presence away just out of the convenience of going through the remaining part of this service. But Lord, let us receive what you're doing right now in this moment in our lives. So that, Lord, we can leave here different than what we come in. Father, we just worship you. We worship you today. Father, you know the hearts and you know the lives of every person that's here. You know what they need today. You know, God, what they desire. Father, we pray, Lord, that you would just show up today. We worship you. Worship you, Jesus. We worship you right now. Church, this is what I feel led. I want you, there's power in community. That's why the enemy fights us so much to not go to church. We find everything else to fill the void of not going, and that's why he fights us, because one of the benefits of coming to church is being able to experience the community of like faith and like believers. And I wish this wasn't the case, but we're really good at putting a mask on when we come to church as everything is okay, when in reality behind that, it's not. And so that's where the power of community comes in, because you never know what that person in front or behind or beside you may be going through, but God does. And that's where the power of corporate and community prayer comes in. And so I'm going to ask you to pray for that person next to you as I pray for you corporately this morning, because God knows exactly what that person needs. And I want you to help me intercede for them this morning. So Father, right now, as we come together as your children and as your church, Father, and we pray for one another, Lord, we pray that fear is broken, that, Lord, that chains are... Lord, we intercede for one another today. We believe that there's power in prayer. We believe that there's power in community prayer. Lord, we believe, God, that you are here today. And Lord, that you're in Jesus' name. Father, we sense your presence in you. Father, we thank you, Lord, that you have met us in this house today. That God, Lord, that you have met us and moved within our lives. Lord, as we lift our hands to you, Lord God, we do so in surrender. Surrender to you today. Lord, we surrender all, Father. We glorify you. We glorify your name, Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 Come on, church. If you receive from the Lord, come on, let's give him a hand clap of praise this morning. Amen. I tell you, if you don't feel that, something's wrong with your feeler. Do you hear what I said? I said, if you don't feel what we feel in this house, something is wrong with your feeler. Amen. Amen. Come on, give Jesus one more hand clap as you are seated. Amen. 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 Thank you, praise and worship team, for leading us. Didn't they do a great job in worshiping this morning? But thank you for listening. This, Brett, you see, this is the difference between what we were talking about just a moment ago. The difference between kind of doing a concert and worship. This is something you have to understand about the Holy Spirit, is that he will never do anything that he's not wanted to do. If you don't want the Holy Spirit to move, he's not going to move. If you want to go through the motions of church, he'll let you just go through the motions. But the moment you say, Holy Spirit, I want you here. We're here to worship God. We're here to declare his goodness. Guess what happens? You just saw what happens. He moves within our lives. And he validates what we needed validated within our lives. You know, the story of David and Goliath is probably one of the most well-known stories, one of the most well-known stories in the Bible. It is a story of God's ability to deliver his people even through a unlikely hero. In the first part of the story, we learn about the challenger to the Israelite army, a man most of us have all heard of, a man by the name of Goliath. And it's through that narrative that we learn about the enemy before us. And ultimately, at the end of the day, that the God that we serve will always be bigger than our enemy. You could not have picked a greater time to come to church than today. Because as we kick off this new series, The Heroes of the Faith, I call it a summer series, if you will. It's about a very familiar story in the Bible, David and Goliath. I remember when I was in Sunday school at Otter Creek Assembly of God, Sister Patty Murphy was my Sunday school teacher. Her son, Joe Pat, that was short for Joseph Patrick. Me and him were very close friends. I was young. We were both young, and I would go over their house on Sundays after church, and we would play in the creek and have fun on his land. And she was my Sunday school teacher, and I remember when she taught the story in class of David and Goliath, because she brought, I know as crazy as it may sound, slingshots to Sunday school. And she brought slingshots with these stones, and she had these empty Coke cans. And she said, "Today, class, we're going to have fun." And in the middle of class, she gave us these slingshots, and she wanted to demonstrate how hard in this story it would be for David to take out Goliath with a slingshot. Found out rather quickly that I wasn't as good with it as I had imagined that I would be. But as we look at that story, we see that it is a story of an unlikely hero, a young shepherd boy, a boy by the name of David. And in this story, he defeats this huge 9-foot giant, an enemy by the name of Goliath. But as I thought about this story, I began to think about how there is so much more to be learned from it than just a simple statement, and that is that God is bigger than my giants. While that is no doubt true, how many of you believe that this morning, that God is always and will always be greater than my giant? How many of you believe that? There is more that you and I can unpack from this story that I believe could be life-changing. And so this morning, as I teach on this text, I want to start from an angle of not David, but I want us to look at the adversary or the enemy, and that is a man by the name of Goliath. If you have your Bibles, I want us to look to 1 Samuel chapter 17. And what we're going to do over the next few weeks is essentially cover this entire chapter. Today we're going to start 1 Samuel chapter 17, starting in verse 1. It says, "Now the Philistines had gathered their armies for battle, and they were gathered at Soko, which belongs to Judah, and encamped between Soko and Azekah and Ephes-Damim." And verse 2 says, "And Saul and the men of Israel were gathered and encamped in the valley of Elah, and drew up a line of battle against the Philistines. And the Philistines stood on the mountain on the one side, and Israel stood on the mountain on the other side, with a valley that was in between them. And there came out of the camp of the Philistines a champion by the name of Goliath of Gath, whose height was 6 cubits and a span. He had a helmet of bronze on his head, and he was armed with a coat of mail, and weight of the coat was 5,000 shekels of bronze. And on he had a bronze armor on his legs, and a javelin of bronze, and slung between his shoulders. The shaft, verse 7, of his spear was like a weaver's beam, and his spear's head weighed 600 shekels of iron, and his shield bearer went before him. He stood and shouted," the Bible says in verse 8, "to the ranks of Israel, 'Why have you come out to draw up for battle? Am I not a Philistine, and are you not servants?'" I want us to remember that. "Are you not servants of Saul? Choose a man for yourselves and let him come down to me. And if he's able to fight with me and kill me, then he will be your servants, or we will be your servants. But if I prevail against him and kill him, then you shall be our servants and serve us." And the Philistine said, "I defy the ranks of Israel today. Give me a man that we may fight together." And when Saul and all of Israel heard these words of the Philistine, the Bible says in verse 11 that they were dismayed and they were greatly, greatly afraid. Now, if we spend just a moment picturing this man by the name of Goliath, the Bible says that he was 9 feet tall. I'm not sure about you, but I've never even really met anybody in person over 7.5 feet tall. You find your favorite NBA player, the guy that the Thunder just drafted the other night, he's 7'2", 7'3". Goliath was almost 2 feet taller than even that guy. So from the exterior view, from Israel's standpoint, it would be very easy to consider defeat. By looking at the exterior of Goliath and his battle testing, it would be really easy to consider defeat. But today, what I want us to do is I want us to learn from Goliath about our present enemy. The Bible tells us in 1 Peter chapter 5 and verse 8 that we have an enemy, and this enemy is doing what? The Bible says that he is prowling around like a roaring lion, seeking someone to devour. You see, you and I, as men and women of God, we must be aware of what our challenger looks like and what our challenger sounds like if we are going to be successful in opposition and in persecution. You see, interestingly enough, our present-day enemy sounds a lot like the Israelite ancient enemies. And so as we compare Goliath to our present enemy today, the very first thing that we take away about Goliath is, and we learn about our present enemy, and that is that the enemy will always, he will always question. Do you notice what Goliath asks in verse number 8? Goliath looks to the Israelites. He looks to the people of God. Now, you got to understand, these people have been through a lot, and God has shown himself faithful to these people many different times. So you would think that they would have an overwhelming faith in the God that had delivered them. You would think that they would have this overwhelming faith in the God that had set them free time and time again. But we see that as Goliath comes out, he asks that question, why are you all coming out to fight? And as we look at Goliath and his many attributes, we could probably name many that are behind those words from Goliath. But the one that I think is the most important is in relation to our own battles with our present enemy is the weapon of doubt. You see, doubt is a, what I would say, an age-old tactic that is used by the devil within our lives even today. Is there anyone here that, man, have you ever battled doubt in your lives? I wish this morning that, man, that I could stand before each and every one of you, and I wish that I could say, man, I've never battled doubt. I mean, boy, I just wake up every single day, and I say, the day is the day that the Lord has made. I'm going to rejoice and be glad. And oh, how many times has that not been reality? I wish that, man, I could stand before each of us and say that, man, I've never battled doubt, but the truth is I've doubted myself. The truth is, this morning, I have doubted my family. I've doubted my church. I've even doubted God. The reality is that we all have this natural tendency to doubt from time to time. And the devil, the evil one, the Goliath of our life, is the king of doubts. He is constantly planting doubts in our heads that lead us to question God. You can even go all the way back to the book of Genesis, the very first book of the Bible, and that's exactly how the enemy operated. In Genesis chapter 3, verse 1, it says, and now the serpent was craftier than any other beast of the field that the Lord had made. And he said to the woman, yeah, that was Eve's fault. I'll say it. Nobody else will. Amen. But he said to the woman, I'm just kidding. Here in this moment, the evil one asks a simple question that caused doubt to slip into the minds of Adam and Eve. And as we look at the enemy's track record, we learn that he is in the business of distracting people just like you and me from the truth that you and I, as men and women of God, may be confronted with. In the case of Goliath, can't you just see the Israelite heads dropping after that question? You know, he is right. Man, we're wasting our time. There's no way I can defeat that big joker. He's 9 foot. I'm small. There is no way. You know, in reality, as they begin to entertain the question that Goliath asked, they had to come to a reality at some point that they asked themselves, you know what? He is right. We are wasting our time. We can't defeat him, and ultimately, we cannot fight against him. But yeah, I want to tell you something wild this morning. You know what? I think the Israelites were completely accurate in their assumptions. They are right. And that right is that they could not defeat Goliath on their own. But there would be soon a warrior that would come up on the scene. And he doesn't try to fight this enemy in his own strength. And there's something, friends, that we can miss if we're not careful. This young warrior comes on the scene, a young shepherd boy who was nothing. He come from the middle of a shepherd field, and he walks up and he says, "You come to me with the spear and the sword, but I come in the name of the Lord." You see, some of us have the wrong perspective on the struggle. We got the wrong perspective on what is warring against us and what you and I are truly warring against. But as you study the scripture, the Bible makes it clear that you and I, no matter who you are, no matter how long you have served the Lord, the Bible makes it clear that we were never meant to fight the enemy on our own. In fact, if we try to do it on our own, I'm telling you, we have a failure rate of 100%. You know, when I was younger, I tried to stop doing the bad things I was doing. I tried to quit doing the drugs, and I tried to quit doing the alcohol. I tried to quit doing all of those things that I'm not proud of. And there was a moment that I stopped for a season, but because Jason was trying to do it on his own, Jason ultimately found himself right back in the pit that he had crawled out of. And what I found is that no matter how much willpower I had, no matter how much determination that I had, I would always fail unless I came to the place in my life that I said, "God, I'm going to let you fight this battle. God, I'm going to let you pull me out of this pit. God, I'm going to let you war against me, against the things that are battling me. God, I'm going to lean upon you because I can't do it." You see, you and I, all of us, I don't care who you are, man, it doesn't matter. We have all received questions from the evil one. And what we need to know as men and what we need to know as women of God is how do we respond to his questions? How do we respond to our Goliaths in our life? How do we respond to the challengers that we face in life? I know this, we don't respond in fear, but faith. Joshua said this in the book of Joshua chapter 1 and verse 9. He says, "Do not be afraid." Amen. "Do not be discouraged." For who? "For the Lord your God will be with you everywhere." Someone say that with me. Everywhere. Everywhere you go. The last time I checked it out, everywhere meant everywhere. The last time I looked it up, everywhere means that every step as a man of God that I take and everywhere I walk, God is with me. Are you with me this morning, church? That no matter where I go, no matter what I do, man, that God is with me. God is my shelter. God is my refuge. And friends, what Joshua is saying is that no matter the challenger, no matter what the evil one says, no matter what he does and what he tries to do, the God that we serve is with us everywhere that we go. He is with us. He is with us when things are going good. Amen. He is with us when everything is falling into place, but he's even with us in the dark seasons. He's even with us in those challenging seasons. He's even with us when we're questioning ourselves and we don't know if there's light at the end of the tunnel. Church, I'm here today to say that no matter what the challenger says, God is before us. God is beside us. But most importantly, God is behind us. You know, interestingly enough, right after Goliath asked this question to the Israelite army, he makes a profound statement. And he says, "I am the Philistine champion. I am the champion. I ride a record of undefeat. But you're only the servants of Saul." Now, for those of us that are not familiar with Saul, Saul was a sissy. Can I say that in church? Yeah, he was a sissy. He was the one that when he received the call to become king, they found him hiding behind boxes. He was the one when the enemy was calling, he would send somebody else. Servant of a coward. But you know what this shows us? It shows us something very important. And that is that he is driven to cause us to question our status, as if status is what brings victory. Did you hear what I just said, church? Some of y'all already eating your roast. Come on now. The enemy wants you to somehow in your mind think that your victory is going to come through your status. Of what you have accomplished. Let me tell you, everything that you have could be taken tomorrow, but just because it is taken doesn't mean you're defeated. Just because everything has been wiped out and everything has been taken, even though all of that has happened, does not mean that you have been defeated. Why? Because you are not defined by your status. You are not empowered by your status, but you are empowered by the Spirit of the living God. I've said it many times, God does not call the qualified, but he qualifies the called, amen. He does not call the ones that are already equipped, but he equips those that he has called, amen. He does not wait for us to get into the middle of the battle and let us reach certain status to give us victory. Before you even step out against the battle, you already have been made victorious. Why? Not because of who you are, not because of what you have accomplished, but you can look that Goliath, you can look that challenger right in the face and say, I'm going to win this thing, not because of who I am. I am a servant of a sissy. I am a failure. I have messed up. But let's guess what? The one that goes before me has already defeated you. Amen. You are on the front lines of a battle that has already been won. You are on the front lines of a war that has already given you victory. Amen. And when you step against this challenger and this one that has voiced himself and questioning who you are, understand this today. You are victorious. I have read the word. I know what the Bible says.
God does not call the qualified, but rather he qualifies the call. The thing that we learn from Goliath is the second thing, the challenger. Is that the enemy, he will condemn. How many of you know that? In verse number 8, Goliath is seeking to elevate himself above the rest of the enemy. Are you with me? In verse 8, it says this, that he stood and he shouted to the ranks of Israel, why have you even came out to draw up for battle? Am I not a Philistine, and are you not the servants of Saul? You see, as we compare Goliath and the Israel army, this is what we see from the exterior. Goliath is big and strong. Goliath is battle-tested. Goliath is undefeated. He is confident. Goliath, this challenger, has a feared reputation. The Israelite army was defeated. In their eyes, they were scared and confused. And as they looked in themselves, it was weak. They were weak in their own eyes. And the Israelite army, based off of those few things, has nothing on this huge challenger, this giant. So on paper, as you see behind me, it's clear that on paper, Goliath, the challenger, has the advantage. And as a result, he speaks with a tone of condemnation. He speaks with a tone of confidence because on paper, he looks like there's no way he can be defeated. But there is an important statement that we can't miss here because it shows us a key tactic of the enemy in our lives as well. As Goliath says, we're speaking about the Israelites. As he was speaking about them, he says that you are only the servants of Saul. A few moments ago, we spoke about doubt, but here I want us to talk just for a moment about trust. That when we remove everything else, who do you and who do we trust? That when we remove everything around us, who do we serve? And when we remove everything, who do you and I as men and women of God look to? You see, it's clear how prominent division is in our world. In fact, I would argue that it is one of the most prominent tactics of the devil amongst God's people. The enemy will do whatever it takes to associate you with anyone but God. He'll do anything to get you away from God. He will do anything to get you out of church. He will do anything to destroy you. He'll do anything to destroy your family. He'll do anything to try to destroy your life. Some of us have associated ourselves with denominational affiliation more than even our identity with Jesus. Others of us are more inclined, look at this, to look at a political leader than God himself for our hope. And when we do, it creates division amongst ourselves and what God wants to do. You see, the difference between the Israelite army and David, as we'll see next week, is perspective on the situation. Ask us this morning, in our own lives, what kind of perspective do we have when we receive questions?
What perspective do you have when the enemy tells you that you're a failure? What perspective do you have when the enemy reminds you how disappointing you are? Anybody here ever disappointed yourself besides me? Hold up all my hands. What is your perspective when the enemy comes into your life and he begins to ask certain questions, and those questions have the potential to rob you of what God wants to do in your life? You see, when you and I, as men and women of God, when we hear a voice of condemnation, do we automatically just believe it to be true? Or if we claim to follow Jesus, that means that we serve a risen Savior, one who is all-powerful. You see, church, it is important to remember this when we sense a false identity being thrown our way by the voice of condemnation. You see, this dialogue between Goliath and this Israelite army comes to a temporary close in verse 11 when the Bible says, "And when Saul and the Israelites heard this, they were what? They were terrified and deeply shaken." Oh, church, how dangerous to give more power to the voice of the enemy than the voice of God. How dangerous is it for not just you, but for your family and for your life and for our church, that we give more power to the challenger than the one who died for us? Oh, what challenge is it that you and I look to the enemy and the enemy tells us of all of our inadequacies, all of our shortcomings, and all, what are we if we believe that rather than believe that we have been washed in the blood? What can make us white as snow? Nothing but the, for us to believe his lies than God's truth. Final thing that we must realize this morning about the challenger, Goliath, or the evil one, is that the enemy will strike fear. Listen to me. We've already talked about how the enemy wants to distract people like you and me from God. I said 2 years ago when COVID hit in that March and we closed down for 9 weeks, and as I prayed and I sought the Lord, I said, "God, what are you doing in this hour?" And I felt in my heart that God was doing two things, that God was bringing the family back together because we get so busy that we miss out on what family is about, but also that God was bringing him back to himself. The enemy is really good at distracting. Fast forward to where we are, where we were then, compared to where we were then, and I think we're further away from God in 22 than we were in 20 when all of it. Because the enemy wants to distract us. He wants to distract us from what is the most important thing. But one of the most prominent tactics, by using things like question, doubts, and condemning words, is to strike fear in your life. Man, I could tell you endless fear in your life. Man, I could tell you endless stories about the seasons of my life that, man, that I was overwhelmed by fear. There'd be times that, man, I'd be looking up at the ceiling, looking at the roof, amen, and just full of fear. The uncertainty, the overwhelmingness of uncertainty, man, endless times of seasons of fear that I was overwhelmed. But in those seasons of my life, though, I shouldn't have been afraid. And there were times that I was. And what I've learned is this, and I close with this, was I was believing lies and I was listening to the wrong voices. And as a result of me listening to other areas of my life, fear will often try to keep us from stepping out in our faith. If you look at Matthew 14, just a few verses, a very familiar story, starting in verse 24, it says, "But the boat by this time was a long way away from the land, beaten by the waves, for the wind was against them. And in the fourth watch of the night, he came to them walking on the sea. But when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were terrified and said that it was a ghost, and they cried out in what? In fear. But immediately," the Bible says, verse 27, "Jesus spoke to them saying, 'Take heart, this is, or it is I, do not be afraid.' And Peter said to them, 'Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water.'" This story that I just read is one of Peter's examples of taking an action of a step of faith. There are four crucial words spoken by Jesus prior to Peter stepping out. And that was to not, do not be afraid. You see, Peter seemed to have the confidence he needed because of the voice that he chose to listen and to trust. That's the question that you and I must be confronted with today. Which voice are we listening to? Which voice are we listening to in order to trust? The Word of God shows us consistently what God's voice actually sounds like. That's why it's important for us to spend time reading it and studying God's Word. You see, we must ask this question: which voice are we listening to in order to trust? I ask us this morning to do this, and in this week to come, consider how you're relying on your own strength and resolve. I challenge you this morning, but not just this morning, this week, to think through some areas where you know you need to ask for help, but you haven't yet. Try to recognize the voice of doubt. Try to recognize the voice of condemnation. Try to recognize the voice of fear. Because remember this, this is not the voice of God in your life. My challenge is you, step into the things of God. Understand, you may not have the greatest reputation. You may be servants of Saul, but at the end of the day, it's not about your status. It's not about your accomplishments. The victory comes through Jesus Christ and Christ alone. Would you stand with me this morning? Father, we come to you this morning and we acknowledge that we were never meant to fight this battle alone. Father, that we are called to look to you. For Lord, we know that you direct the stone from the slingshot. We know that we have a challenger. We know that we have an adversary, and he's constantly bringing doubt and fear and condemnation. But God, that's not from you. That's to get us to not step out into battle. But Father, today that's going to change. Lord, today that is going to change. No longer are we going to listen to the voice of the challenger, but we're going to step out by faith, just as Peter did when he heard Jesus' voice. And we're going to fight this battle, not on our own, because we know we're going to lose, but we're going to fight it because we know that you are with us, just as Joshua declared. This morning, with every head bowed and every eye closed, maybe you're here today and you don't know Jesus as the Lord of your life. Jesus can't guide you. He can't protect you. He can't battle for you if you don't make him the Lord of your life. And the reality is this, that you need forgiveness of your mistakes. You need forgiveness of your sins. And maybe that didn't make complete sense to you, but I believe that the Holy Spirit is drawing your heart now if you're here today. That even if you don't have full understanding, you know there's something on the inside that's telling you that your life needs to be right with the Lord. So I'm just going to ask very briefly this morning, with every head bowed and every eye closed, that if you don't know Jesus, I want you just to slip that hand up and say, "Preacher, I need to know Jesus. I need to know. I need to dedicate. I need to give my life to him." Anybody here today? Second thing I want to do this morning, if everybody would just look at me just for a moment. You know, when I open the Bible and I say, okay, see if I can find altar calls in the Bible. I really can't find a scripture that says, preach a sermon and give an altar call. But altar calls are important. There's two things I want us to understand. Is that oftentimes in the Bible, there would be an altar and there would be sacrifices that would take place on those altars. And so when you look at these tonight, or this morning rather, we see that we come to these altars because we want to sacrifice whatever it is. So when we give you an invite to come to the altar, we're giving you an invite to sacrifice. Like if you're battling fear, it's giving you an invite to come and sacrifice. The altar call was actually initiated by a man by the name of Charles Finney. He was one of the first ones that gave the altar call hundreds of years ago, or over 100 something years ago. And after Charles Finney gave the altar calls, then we see that there would be some others, Moody, some of the greatest evangelists and revivalists of the modern time, gave the altar call, and they saw that God was doing something because people would come and lay aside what people were thinking, and they would bring whatever to the altar and sacrifice, and God began to move that way. Hence is why we give altar calls. And so when we do that, we're not doing it to try to shame somebody or make someone, we're giving you an opportunity to sacrifice. An opportunity to lay down whatever it is that you're battling and leaving it at the altar of the Lord. That's why it's important. And that's why we will always have altar calls, Lord willing. And this morning, the reason why I shared all of that, because some of this stuff is new to some of us. Why do they want us to come to the altar? Why is this man or this woman doing this? Why? And we want to educate, and we want to give you the reasoning behind some of the things that we do, but it's very important that we come to the altar. Can God do whatever he needs to do right there where you are? Absolutely. But there's just something about stepping out and sacrificing at the altar of the Lord, whatever it is that you need in your life. And this morning, I'm going to pray over you. And man, if you're battling fear, or you're battling doubt, or you've been listening to the challenger's voice of condemnation, doubt, or whatever it is, I just believe that something's going to happen this morning if you will just step out and bring it to these altars. Nobody is going to look. Nobody's going to judge. And nobody's going to bring condemnation for you doing that. I believe in my spirit this morning that, man, that there's people here that have been listening to the voice of the challenger, and that voice is destroying your life. And your spiritual maturity and growth and all of these other things hinge on whether or not you let God do what he wants to do in your life. And so this morning, what I'm going to do is I'm going to begin praying. And if you're here and you say, man, I've been listening to the challenger. I've been listening to the voice of Goliath. You're just a servant of Saul. Today that stops. Your past is your past. The reminding of the enemy